So I think we are at 10:05. I think it's time to start. Thank you all for joining us again on this Friday morning. My name is Moriana Garcia. I am the STEM and Scholar and Communications Librarian at the University of Rochester, River Campus Libraries. And I will be presenting this workshop on understanding CC licenses. Two of my colleagues today, Kim Hoffman and Stephanie Barrett, will be my co-host, and they will be managing the recording and the chat. I will ask you that you add your questions to chat, and when we reach the end of the presentation, I will answer your questions, and I will go back to the slides if we have to. That way we can get through the entire presentation without interruptions, and then we get all the questions at the same time. The idea is to have most of the program in the first hour, and then we have an extra half hour to answer more specific questions, to explore some of the websites, to test some of the ideas, try to find open access materials, combine them, remix them, decide on the licenses. So it will be the hands-on part on after the 1 hour presentation. So I will start sharing my screen now. This program is being recorded. So our presentation today is titled Understanding Creative Commons Licenses, and is part of the OpenApp series, dealing with open pedagogy and OER materials. First of all, as usual, I'm a librarian. I need to make this disclaimer that I'm not allowed or qualified to provide legal advice. So what I can do is provide you with information on copyright and licensing practices in academia that you can use to guide your own decisions. So no legal advice here. And a lot of the content from this presentation was created during my recent Creative Commons certificate. I took a course and I ended that course a couple of weeks ago. So it's kind of very new. Some of the content is very new, but it has been vetted by my professors during the course. So I'm pretty confident about it. So what is Creative Commons? Well, Creative Commons is several things at the same time. And if you are familiar with the website, Creative Commons in reality is three different things. Now is a set of legal tools, and those are the CC licenses that we are gonna discuss today. But Creative Commons is also a nonprofit organization trying to advance openness and open scholarship in worldwide. And in fact, it's a worldwide movement. They have a global network that actually has representatives in a lot of different countries around the world. So it's all of those things, a set of legal tools, a nonprofit organization, and a worldwide movement. Creative Commons started in 2001, and they released the first set of licenses in 2002. There are currently more than 1.6 billion items with current Creative Commons licenses in all types of formats, from text to video to music to 3D models. And why Creative Commons appear? So Lawrence Lessig, actually a lawyer from Boston, from Harvard, a professor and lawyer, was the one that he and some other colleagues created Creative Commons Creative Commons licenses. And the idea was to help alleviate the disconnect between what technology allows people to do with the internet and the web, and their restrictions on copying and reusing creative contents that are established by copyright law. Our copyright law it lasts a very, very long time, and it's not in sync in a sense with how easy it is to share materials using the internet or the web. Also, a big purpose of the organization is to contribute open content to what they call the global commons, and in that way advance human knowledge and creativity. And if you want to learn more about the history of Creative Commons, you can click on that link. It's a Padlet with some of the history behind the creation of Creative Commons. This presentation, we will share the slides and the recording with everybody that attended, so don't worry about notes. So, what CC licenses do? So the set of legal tools from Creative Commons. Well, CC licenses allow creators to give a set of permissions over their work to the public, as long as some requirements are maintained. And the licenses are free, but they are legally enforceable. And more important, they are irrevocable. That's something that people need to understand very clearly. Once you share some content under a Creative Commons license, yes, as the copyright owner, you can stop sharing the content anytime you want. But if someone finds your original content with the original license, Creative Commons license in the wild, they are allowed to continue using the content under that license. So that's an important concept. So what is the relationship between CC licenses and copyright? Well, CC licenses run on top of copyright. So CC licenses need copyright to exist, to function. And they last as long as the copyright exists. So it's not that they don't last forever, they last the same time that the copyright lasts, or until any terms are violated. So you can lose the right to license a content if you violate the terms. When copyright does not apply, CC licenses do not apply either. So for example, there are a series of limitations and exceptions such as fair use to copyright. And if you apply those to the use of your work, then complying with the CC licensing terms might not be necessary. When limitations and exceptions to copyright apply, you don't need to abide by the Creative Commons licensing terms. Because CC licenses run on top of copyright, I need to cover the basics of copyright. I'm not sure where you are on copyright, how much do you know? So I will do a kind of a general overview of the basics of copyright, so we are all on the same place. So copyright, the basics, and the very, very basics, yes? So copyright is a legal protection provided to the creators of original works of authorship that are registered in a tangible medium. So your work needs to be registered in a tangible medium, and it could be a digital medium, could be a digital copy. And what copyright does is provide exclusive rights to the author to copy the work, to distribute, to perform, to adapt, or display. Basically, it gives the complete control over how your work is shared or reused. Some of those individual rights, so the right to copy or distribute or perform, can be licensed or transferred to someone else. And that happens a lot in academia when people want to publish in a journal or with a book publisher. Sometimes they sign copyright agreements where they transfer the entire rights to someone else. That means that you can have an author, someone could be an author of some content, but the copyright owner is different. And it's the copyright owner actually who has the control over all these rights, not the original author if has signed a transfer agreement. Currently in the United States is the life of the author plus 70 years. It's a long, long time. Depending on the life of the author, but you know, it's very, very long until the copyright ends. And copyright legislation is by jurisdiction, so every country has its own laws. There are some international agreements where all countries abide by some agreements, but each country has its own copyright law. And if you want to learn more about copyright, there is an excellent publication from the Copyright Office called Copyright Basics, and that link takes you to it. It will also be on my reference list, and I found that publication very easy to follow. So the main purpose of copyright is, there are two. One is what is called the utilitarian view of copyright. It provides economic incentive to creators in order to encourage the creation of new works. So you have this control, so you can profit from your content in order that you are incentivized to create more content, so you get more economic incentives. But with the very long, long time that we now have over copyright, some people said, I'm not sure how much you are incentivizing new creation if you have, if basically lasts forever. So there is a lot of criticism of the utilitarian idea. Other parts of copyright, the other purpose is to protect author rights. And it protects what is called the moral rights of creators, which is attribution, and also the integrity of the creative work. So it can protect your work, so others cannot use, in a sense, your work in ways that you do not approve, for example, or they can destroy your work, etc. So, but once you transfer your copyright, I'm not sure how much your moral rights are still protected. Well, they are in a sense, but it gets a bit more complicated after you transfer if an author transfers its copyright. You don't need to go the list. I just copy from that publication on copyright basics. So what is protected under copyright law and is mostly creative works, including collections and translations or adaptations of those works, and includes literary and non-literary works, musical works, dramatic works, almost anything that is in a tangible medium nowadays, it's protected under copyright. What is not protected, and that's important, is facts, ideas, and useful items. So ideas are not protected. If you do not put your idea in a tangible medium, it's not copyrighted to you. So, facts, ideas, and useful items, titles, familiar symbols, or lists of ingredients. So here are some of the things that are protected or not. And copyright is not the only part of intellectual property rights. Intellectual property rights control intellectual property over several things. There are others like patents, which give inventors the exclusive rights to make use or sell their inventions for a limited time. And I think it's 17 years currently. And also trademarks, which identifies the owner of a brand, name, term, design, symbol, representing a particular product or service. So these are not protected by copyright. They have their own legislation. And Creative Commons licenses do not apply to patents or trademarks, only to copyrighted items. How do you obtain copyright? Well, it's automatic. Copyright is automatic from the moment the work is fixed in a tangible medium, and you don't need to have any copyright notice or registration. You put in a tangible medium, you have copyright over that content, which makes sometimes very difficult to identify who is the copyright owner of a particular content if there is no notice there. You can register your copyright, and that provides you extra protection in case of a lawsuit. And you can get some monetary advantages if you register your copyright before the lawsuit starts. When you go into a lawsuit, you will have to register to actually engage legally in a dispute about copyright. Of course, there are works that are not under copyright, and we call those works on the public domain. So public domain works are creative works that are not subject to copyright, and there are a lot of reasons. The most common is the copyright has expired. So the author passed away and 70 years have passed, and now the work enters automatically into the public domain. As a rule of thumb, you can assume or that anything created after 1924 might be copyrighted. There is a period there when where you had to comply with formalities to maintain your copyright. So there is a gray period. But you anything created after 1924, you might expect that it might be under copyright. There are things, as we saw, patents, trademarks, etc., some content that is never entitled to copyright. Creators can actually dedicate their content to the public domain, and then although theoretically the copyright exists, the creator has dedicated the content. And in some, as I said, in a period there, if or in particular countries, if the creator failed to comply with some formalities, then the work entered into the public domain. There is a Creative Commons dedication. It's not exactly a license. It's called the Creative Commons Zero or Public Domain Dedication. And it basically says no rights reserves. People can actually use this in any way they want. There are some, as I mentioned, there are exceptions and limitations to copyright. And those grant the public the right to use copyrighted work without permission under very specific circumstances. And some of the examples of the exceptions and limitations are fair use, reproduction by libraries and archives, transfer of a particular copy. So after you purchase something, you can transfer the ownership to someone else, exceptions to particular performances and displays, and secondary transmission of broadcast programming on TV. So there are some exceptions where you don't need to ask permission. In all the other cases, you need the permission of the copyright owner to reuse, copy, distribute the content. I want to talk a little bit more of fair use because it's very important for scholars, teachers, librarians, educators, and also because it's one of the exceptions that might apply to Creative Commons licenses. So if you have a material with a particular Creative Commons license and you want to go beyond that and it falls under fair use, you can. You don't need to abide by the license. So fair use allows users to use portions of copyrighted work for a specific purpose like teaching, criticism, news reporting, and research without seeking permission. And there are four factors to consider. And it's basic risk analysis. You need to think about the purpose of the use, what you want to do with this. So it is criticism, it is educational purposes, it is news reporting. What is the nature of the copyrighted work? So facts, it's better than fiction. Also the amount and substantiability of the portion used. That means, are you going to use the entire book, only one chapter? If in a photograph, an image, are you going to use only part of the image? And the substantiality, that's the word. It's very important because, okay, you might have a book with 10 chapters, but there is only one chapter that is, you know, has all the new information. If you're going to use that chapter, the one that actually everybody buys the book only to read that is very substantial to the book. So it's only one chapter, but it, in a sense, it represents the entire book. And that might be a problem. And finally, the effect on the potential market. So the idea is the copyright owner is making economic profits from this. Is if you are sharing freely, is this gonna harm the copyright owner profitability in a sense? Something that is discussed a lot in fair use is what is called the transformative use of the content. And it's because in fair use assumes that you are or transforming the content in a way that is, it changes enough that now is different, or you transform the purpose of the content. And there is a discussion between derivative and transformative. Derivative is an adaptation of a work. And we will see in the presentation, in advance in the presentation, a better definition of a derivative or an adaptation. But for fair use, for you to claim fair use, your use of the work needs to be considered in a sense transformative. So or you are transforming the content or you are transforming the purpose. Finally, and here is the connection with the Creative Commons, is that you can have licenses and contracts attached to your copyright rights, yes? And a license is a grant by the holder of a copyright or patent to another of any of the rights embodied in the copyright or patent, short of all an assignment of all rights. If you assign all rights to someone else, you are basically transferring your copyright. But if you are not transferring, if you are keeping, you can still create a license that allows the other party to use some of those rights. A contract is a binding agreement between two or more persons or parties, especially one that is legally enforceable. And Creative Commons licenses are licenses where you make a contract with a user about how they can use some of your rights. You assign to them some of your rights. Something very important to understand is that the Creative Commons licenses, they have layers. They have what you call three different components. One is the legal code. And you can go to the Creative Commons website and actually access the legal code. And it's, you know, in legalese, so you know lawyer's language. And it's very, very complete. And it's the one that provides the information. Here is the contract. That's the real contract. It's the legally enforceable terms and conditions. Then the common deeds. This is a summary in lay terms. So it's a summary, so it's easy to understand. Ah, this is what I can do, attribution, etc. And then finally, there is a machine readable version, which is a license description that is understood by software. And when you use the icons from Creative Commons licenses, those icons have machine readable terms embedded in the image, in the metadata of the image. So software can understand and recognize that that material is used. That's why you need to use icons for the Creative Commons, so Creative Commons icons, when you assign a license, because that icon is gonna have that machine readable code. To select a license is very easy. You go to the Creative Commons website and there's a link saying share your work, and they actually walk you through the process of choosing some of the licensing features. You can select optional information for your license and you put your information as the author, and then you get a license. So you get the icon, you get the license. You can, even if you have a website, they allow you to copy some code that you can embed with your license. They are trying a new selector that they call Chooser Beta. That is now, it's even more easy to follow. So you can go the traditional selector or you can test the new beta. I really like the beta one. That's very easy. So let's talk about the CC licenses themselves. And they are composed of four basic elements that you can combine to create the CC licenses. The first is attribution. Or by, and it's a requirement for all CC licenses, and basically tells you that you need to provide credit to the licensor. That means you need to provide, it's the attribution is related to the author rights, yes, to tell who created and who has the copyright actually, which can be different, yes, so who created and who has the copyright of that work. Then there is a term called non-commercial or NC, where the requirement for those licenses is that you use those materials only for non-commercial purposes. And we will talk later about details of all of those. But basically, you cannot use any material licensed with NC for commercial purposes. So you cannot have profits, for example, on those materials. You cannot sell them for profit. Then there is one called no derivatives. And the requirement is that RAID users cannot share the any adaptations. In the last, CC licenses have passed, have had several versions. So the version 1.0 and then 2.0, they are now in the 4.0 versions. In the last non-derivative version, someone can make adaptations on a work with ND, but they cannot share. So they can make adaptations for themselves, but they cannot share. So it's kind of a private adaptation. Private adaptations are allowed, but not public adaptations. And finally, the shared alike, where the requirement is that any adaptation might use the same license as the original material. And it's adaptations that needs to use that license. Okay. So there is a lot of language here that we need to unpack a little bit, yes? But first, when you combine all elements, you can create 6 licenses. And something that, you know, I only realized very recently is that there is no combination of a share alike, no derivatives. Why? Because both applies to adaptations. And if you cannot create, if you cannot share an adaptation, then share alike doesn't apply. So ND and SA cannot be combined, is why you have 6 combinations. One is the attribution, just that, and you can, users can use the word for any purpose as long as you give attribution to the creator. All the others have the attribution, so attribution is always there. The attribution share alike, you can use the word for any purpose as long as you give attribution, and make any adaptations you share available under the same or a compatible license. The attribution non-derivative is you can use the work with any adaptations without any adaptations for any purpose as long as you give attribution to the creator. So you give attribution and you can reuse, you can share the work, but as is, you cannot change it. The non-commercial, you can use the work for non-commercial purpose only, and only as long as you give attribution. Combination of non-commercial and shared alike, you can use the work for non-commercial purpose only, you need to give attribution, and if you make any adaptations, you need to share with the same or a compatible license. Finally, the attribution non-commercial, no derivatives, this is the most restrictive license of all the Creative Commons. You can use the work for non-commercial purpose only, you need to give attribution, and if you and make any adaptations to share. Oh my God! Ah, I have an error in my thing. No, I copied the same text and the previous. So, correcting. So, no commercial purpose. You need to give attribution, and you cannot share any adaptations of the work. Okay, so you cannot make adaptations. You need to share as they are, similar to this. So, considerations about attribution. Basically, it protects the author's moral rights, okay? And we call attribution citations in academia, yes? The citations, the references. If you're using an image, make sure that you have a caption where you cite the rights. And attribution is a requirement for all 6 licenses. According to Creative Commons, it should be done in a reasonable manner based on the medium, means, and context. So if you have a website, you know, usually in the footer of the website is where you can put some of that information, the license that you want. In videos, you can embed in the description, the metadata. So where you are going to put your licenses needs to be done in a reasonable manner, or the attribution. Something important is an author can request removal of the attribution if they do not agree with what you are doing, if they don't want to be seen as part of whatever you are doing. So the license allows you to use materials in any way you want, depending on the license, for example, a CC BY. But the author might not agree with your use, and they are allowed legally to request the removal of the attribution. So you can still use the work, but their name is not attached to it. And reusers are prohibited from using attribution in any way that suggests that you are endorsing the views of the reuser. So that is part of that idea. Any change made to the original licensed works must be indicated by the reuser with a link back to the original, and that needs to be provided. So if you modify, you need to tell me, I modify this, it's changed from the original, and here is a link to the original. An example of attribution, Creative Commons recommends the TASL format, which is the title of the work, the author, the source, and the license, with links. So links to the author, links to the source, links to the license. The title, it's now optional because a lot of works do not have a title. But if you have a title, it's good. So TASL is the format that is recommended, and all with links. The links should be machine readable. And if the idea is that you make your content ADA compliant. So here is an example of attribution, yes. Image from is coming from here. The original credits is from something else. And actually this link doesn't work anymore, but here is where the original was. So I now put, okay, this image came from this place. Originally was this, it has this type of licensing under this criteria. So I need to speed up, and I have a lot of slides to go. So non-commercial, what are the considerations? Basically, the definition of non-commercial is not primarily intended for or directed towards commercial advantage or monetary compensation. And it's focused on profit. So selling at cost value might be exempt. And a lot of depends on case law. So it's not exactly well defined when that is selling at cost value. But for example, you can sell something that is has a Creative Commons license. If you don't profit, if you are just selling because printing the material and you are selling the print version, cost that much. Of course, this only applies to a reuser. The owner of the copyright, they can sell for as much profits as they want. The copyright owner has the control. They can sell beyond the terms of the license. It's people that are reusing the material that cannot do that. Advertisement counts as commercial. So, my YouTube channel, my blog with advertisement, that is commercial. So you need to be careful. And something important is related to the type of use, not the user. So a non-for-profit organization might have commercial uses for content. And the same thing, a for-profit organization might use the content in a non-commercial manner. So it's linked to the use, not to the user. Share alike considerations. Requires all derivatives of a work to be licensed under the same or a compatible license as the original. Only affects adaptations. So it needs to be an adaptation and prevents reusers from adding new restrictions to adaptations. That's the main thing. So if you share in a way, you prevent reusers from, when they create an adaptation, now adding more restrictions to that content. And all CC BY SA or CC BY NCSA versions 2.0 or higher are compatible. So you can assign a later version license to something that has been shared with a previous SA version. It complicates a lot the compliance for remixes because you need to check that the licenses are compatible and you can reshare under the same license. Finally, no derivatives. And what is the considerations? Allows people to copy and distribute a work, but prohibit them from adapting, remixing, transforming, translating, or updating in any way that makes a derivative. So you can only share verbatim copies of the content. You can share, you can use, but verbatim. You can modify and adapt the content, but only for yourself, you cannot share. What constitutes an adaptation is not exactly well defined. There is a definition, but it's not exactly, and prevents the content to be considered an open educational resource. So if you sign a no derivatives license, if you choose for your materials, then it's not considered an OER. And transformative use might be an option in this case. Of course, you can always ask permission from the original author. The fact that you cannot do something related to the license doesn't prevent you from contacting a copyright owner and request other things. Finally, Creative Commons and the public domain. CC licenses cannot be assigned to works on the public domain. However, CC licenses has some public, because public domain is not under copyright and you need copyright for CC licenses. But there are two tools, the CC zero and the public domain mark, that CC license distributes and manage, that you can use. In this CC zero, creators share their work with no rights reserved. And the work is put in the public domain if allowed by the jurisdiction. Some jurisdictions, you don't allow you to put your work on the public domain even if you want to. And the public domain mark is something, is a label that you can use to mark things that you know are on the public domain. So you can tell others, oh, there is no mark here, but I know that this is in the public domain, and you can add the public domain mark to help others use that content. Okay, now is the idea, what if you want to use several pieces, if you want to combine a lot of materials. This is not just about choosing a license or understanding what are the limitations, but what if you want to combine different materials with different CC licenses? Here is where you need to differentiate between a collection and an adaptation. A collection brings together a series of independent works in a new whole, but it still keeps those as separate objects. So you don't modify them, you don't change them, you just collect them in a new whole. And the items in the collection can be shared without modifications, except format changes and spelling corrections under the original copyright terms and licenses. But be careful, because a translation is considered an adaptation. And you can apply your own licensing terms to your own contribution. And that means, you know, your introduction, your preface, or the arrangement of the objects. But the objects themselves, each of them keep their own copyright. So they are not adaptations, you are just collecting them. If you create a collection that includes one or more different works, you need to provide correct attribution to each item in your collection, use the tassel. However, here is the only restriction to your collection. If any of the works is licensed under an NC non-commercial, then you cannot use your collection for commercial purposes. So if any of the works says NC, then your own collection cannot be used commercially. Other licensing restrictions attached to works in the collection, such as essay or ND, are not a problem as long as the works are shared without modifications, because those two apply only to adaptations. If you share the work verbatim, no problem in your collection. Here is a schema about how you decide when you create a collection, how is the license compatibility. And you see that the restrictions mostly are for NC. So if you have NC, you cannot use for commercial purposes. If not, in collections, pretty much every license is compatible in the collection with your own licensing terms. It's just the non-commercial that are non-compatible with commercial use of the collection. An example of a collection, here is my licensing terms. So I put except otherwise noted. So if each material in the collection has its own attribution. The rest of the content is licensed by Mariana Garcia, University of Rochester, under CC BY by Attribution International. And here's my collection. For example, you see, I used a lot of images of frogs. And can you see the images of the frogs? Yes, okay, perfect. Yes. Because I don't see the green rectangle. And each image has its own licensing terms. And I just added a license that only applies to my content, which is this little introduction. Okay, the rest, I'm using each work as verbatim, so no problem. I need to worry about other license compatibilities. None of them is NC. Moving forward, here is something different. So here is, you are not creating a collection. You are actually mixing up. You are mixing up, you are doing a remix, a derivative, or an adaptation of a work. And for Creative Commons, the words remixes, derivatives, or adaptations are taken as synonyms. So an adaptation is a new work derived from or based on a copyrighted work with enough additional contributions to guarantee copyright protection to the modifications. As I said, it's not exactly clear. So how much of your original contributions warranty copyright protection? To be safe, anything. We have discussed about cropping an image. If you crop an image, you are modifying, even if you're just taking part of the sky, you know, you are modifying that image, that might be considered a derivative. So it's very fuzzy about what will warranty enough additional contributions. And that definition varies from jurisdiction to jurisdiction to country. So a lot of is decided on case law. There is an adapter's license charge. So where you see, this is the status of the original work. This is the license. And this is the license that you can assign to your adaptation. Okay, so adapters on the top, license of the original work on the side. The green is it's permitted. The yellow is permitted but not recommended. And the gray is absolutely not permitted. So you see that you need to be careful about what is the work. If you want to assign to your contribution another license, you need to check this chart. Okay? And license compatibility for adaptations is that your adapter's license only applies to your own contributions to the adaptation. If any of the original works has a non-derivative restriction, you can adapt the work only for yourself, but not share. If any of the original works has an NC restriction, you cannot use your adaptation commercially. And it's recommended that you would actually use an NC restriction for your own license. If any of the original work has an SA restriction, you need to use the same licensing restriction or something that is compatible for your adaptation. The advantage is that you can use later versions of an SA license after the SA 1.0. There is a very nice graph that you can check to show which CC license works can be remixed. This is two different works that you are mixing up in one whole. And you can see which the green can be remixed, the X cannot be remixed. Okay, if we want, we can explore more of those charts in the extra half hour, and we can go and discuss specific examples. Here is just an example of an adaptation. I choose two works, you know, a photo of the sky, a photo of a frog, and I put them together and I call it Dreaming Under the Stars. This is my license, and I need to tell this is mandated by the CC licensing legal terms. This is a derivative of Star by Kiwi Tom, licensed under CC BY, and Frog by Sailor Bill, licensed under CC BY. So it's a lot of work to be legal, to be good. I could claim fair use, yes, I'm teaching, I don't need to abide, but we need to be good. We need to be responsible. And in academia, we cite our sources. So this is the right way to cite my adaptation of those works. How to avoid copyright problems? Create your own content. That is the easiest. Or use content with the appropriate license, or get permission for copyright content. You can always contact the copyright notary and ask for additional permissions. You can buy content, and the best thing is educate yourself about what you can and you cannot do. And you're here, so you are already on that pathway. There are a lot of places where you can find this licensed content. Creative Commons has its own search called Creative Commons Search that allows you to find videos and images and a lot of different content that is has a CC license. Then, of course, in YouTube, you can use the filters to find videos with Creative Commons. You can use the advanced search in Google also to select particular usage rights. So for commercial or non-commercial that you can adapt or not adapt. Those are related to the NC and the ND versions of Creative Commons. And of course, all the Wikipedia, Wikimedia tools use content that is licensed for public use. So you can use Wikimedia Commons, for example, to find a lot of materials with CC licenses. Of course, as I said, you can always ask permission if you need extra things. What you need to do is identify the copyright owner, and that can be tricky. You need to contact the copyright owner and you need to write a permission request. And that needs to be in writing. So it needs to be an email or a letter, phone, verbal thing, agreements do not count. It needs to be in writing. And get the response in a tangible medium, so letter or email, and keep a record of the permission if you get additional permissions. And this link goes to an example of a form that you can use to ask permissions. But to be honest, the most important thing is actually to educate yourself. Educate yourself about copyright, educate about the rights that you have as a creator and the rights that you have by when you want to use other people's work. We have a LibGuide at Rochester and our library about copyright and fair use, where you can find a lot of materials to guide you on that. You can check the Creative Commons website. They have a lot of definitions, materials, all the legal documents. It's a great website to explore. And you can actually check the Creative Commons certificate materials, the ones that I took, that it gives you an entire overview of Creative Commons. All the materials are available online, open access. If you take the certificate course with a professor and a cohort and dates, then you get an official certificate, but anybody can access and read the materials on their own. And they are very easy to follow. And finally, talk to your librarian. Okay, your librarian can help you find examples and analyze and help you make decisions on those without legal advice, remember. We do not provide legal advice, but we provide information. This presentation is part of the Open Education Workshop series. It's an event series trying to open up our coursework through resources, pedagogy, and conversation about open. It's based on the book Open Pedagogy Approaches, Faculty, Library, and Student Collaborations, and open access books with examples of case studies where people, faculty, librarians, and students collaborating on open pedagogy projects. The next event in the series is the Open Up, Orienting to OER and Open Pedagogy. And here is the link to the event. I believe it's happening on January 7th. Yes, I think it's January 7th. Here are my list of references with links, so you can go and check some of the materials. The frequently asked questions from Creative Commons has all those tables about the reuse, remixes, and compatibility. You can find them here in the frequently asked questions. So I have reached the end of the presentation in time. That's a miracle. And we can use the additional half hour to explore the content and find any open content, check the rights, check what are the options if you want to reuse. You will receive a copy of the presentation and the materials. Okay? So I'm going to stop sharing so I can see the questions and hear about that.